And I will make you fishers of men.
Alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus was standing one day by the lake of Gennesaret with a crowd pressing round him, listening to the word of God, when he caught sight of two boats close to the bank. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, it was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and pay out your nets for a catch."
"Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all night long and caught nothing. But if you say so, I will pay out the nets." And when they had done this, they netted such a huge number of fish that their nets began to tear. So they signaled to their companions in the other boats to come and help them. When these came, they filled the two boats to sinking point. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at the knees of Jesus, saying, "Leave me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were completely overcome by the catch they had made. So also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were Simon's partners. But Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, it is men you will catch." Then, bringing their boats back to land, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
As we listen to the word of God, which the church proclaims to us today, that the kind of theme that runs through all the readings is that notion of being called by God. And it reminds me of a film that I saw recently called The Courier. And it's basically about a businessman who is approached by the CIA and the MI6, and they want him, because he does business in Moscow, they want him to become a courier. They have a mole, a spy, inside the Soviet regime, and they're wanting information about the buildup of missiles in Cuba. And so they approach this businessman to recruit them. And this is how it goes.
"No.
It was Penkovsky's idea. You're perfect. You're a civilian, so the KGB won't be watching. You'll be in and out of Moscow anyway to set up contracts. You still won't know any specifics. You'll just be a courier."
"Just a courier? For Russian secret?"
"We've gone over it with Penkovsky. We believe the risk to you is minimal. And we'll pay you."
"I make my own money. Thank you very much. I have a wife and a child. Either of you have a family?"
"Oh, no.
Don't suppose you could tell me about that. Not a lot you can tell me about, is there, Helen? James?"
"I can tell you we've both put ourselves in harm's way when necessary, and this is terribly necessary, Greville."
"Then might I suggest you find someone who's suited for it?"
He's not biting. And he puts up the arguments about why he doesn't want to get involved in this. But you know, even though he's saying, "Find someone else who can do this," he eventually agrees to do it. They touch his sense of loyalty to his country. And so the full film is about what happens as he does this. And it strikes me that this pattern is seen in the scriptures. You know, very often with the prophets, we see it with Isaiah today, you know, they don't want God to call them. They don't agree with what God is asking them to say, and they don't agree that they're the best person to do it. There's a resistance always with the prophets that initially their reaction to God is, no, I don't want this. And you can kind of understand it. You know, the thing about being a prophet is prophets are never sent in a time when everything goes well. Prophets are always sent to a generation that's in a bad place. And so we can look at the job description of a prophet. Apply for this job. Your job is to bring criticism and condemnation to the ruling authorities, both of the palace and the temple, as well as the populace at large. You're there to bring bad news, to challenge, to cajole, to invite people to a different way of being. And that never goes down well. It's never something that people want to do. You know, a prophet never comes among the people and says, you're doing really well, keep on going the way you are and have a nice day. That's not what prophets do. Prophets say, you need to change. The course you're on is not God's course. And so the prophets are reluctant to become prophets. They're reluctant to respond to God's invitation that he makes to them. And there's an added problem for prophets, that if they do start to prophesy, to proclaim to the people what God wants, then immediately they're going to be asked, by what authority do you do this? Who do you think you are telling us what to do and how to behave? So that there's a kind of process that goes on with the process of calling a prophet. It begins with initial encounter. We see it in the first reading today. The prophet Isaiah has this vision of heaven. He has a vision of God in his glory and his throne and his majesty. You know, and he sings out, holy, 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 the very prayer that we use at Mass today. It's a moving encounter. But what it moves Isaiah to believe is that he's not worthy. His immediate reaction in seeing this holy sight is to recognize his own sinfulness. You know, the temptation for the prophet or the one who is called is to say, I'm not good enough to be called by God. And then the process moves on and God confirms his choice. You are good enough because I call you. You know, and we see God sending this angel that burns the tongue of the prophet Isaiah and heals him of his sins and equips him for the task ahead. And then there's the preparation for the task. God says, whom shall I send? And Isaiah immediately jumps up and says, send me. You know, he's done a complete U-turn from saying, I'm not the person that you want to call, to send me. I'm available. I want to proclaim your word. And we see something similar going on in the gospel today. It opens with the scene of Jesus being crushed in by the crowd who were all listening to the word of God, we are told. They're hungry. They want to hear what Jesus has to say. But then we contrast that with Simon Peter. He's still Simon at this stage. And here he is on the beach washing his nets after a night fishing. And we can kind of glean that he wasn't a happy man. It was a wasted night as far as Simon was concerned. And Simon is not there to listen to Jesus. We can probably discern that, in fact, Jesus in this crowd was a bit of a nuisance for Simon. He just wants to wash his nets, wrap up, go home, get something to eat, and go to bed. He's not interested in what Jesus has to say. He's not there to listen to Jesus. He's there to finish up a hard night's work. And so Jesus invites Simon to take him out on his boat a wee bit so that he can speak to the crowds properly. Now, what's happening there is where Jesus was preaching is a kind of bay area. And What Jesus is doing is he's creating a stage where he can talk to the crowds just a wee bit offshore so that everyone can see him and hear him. The water would deflect the sound and amplify the sound. So it would be a wee bit like, imagine this is the boat and you're on the beach. That's what Jesus was doing. But I think there was something more profound going on in what Jesus is doing. This isn't about letting the crowd see Jesus and hear Jesus. This is about Simon. Because what Jesus has done has taken a disinterested Simon, put him in the boat beside him, so Simon now has no choice but to listen to Jesus. He's there. He can't escape it. He hears what Jesus is saying. And it reminds us all that, you know, God really wants us to listen to his word. He really wants us to listen to those ways that he encounters us during the week and during the day. We need to be listeners. You know, we believe it or not, that even at Mass here today, even as I stand and speak to you, God is using me to talk to you. And I have to remind myself as a preacher that when I preach, God is talking to me. You know, over the course of this weekend, I've had to listen to this homily twice. So think yourself lucky. You know, God is doubling his effort with me. He wants us to listen. He wanted Simon Peter to listen. And that was really important. And then he says to Simon Peter, you know, let's go fishing. And we hear Simon, come on. More or less, what Simon says is, Jesus, you stick to preaching, I'll look after the fishing. You know, Simon thinks Jesus is out of his depth here. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And to understand that, we need to know something about how the fishermen fished in Lake Gennesaret at that time. You see, the thing is the lake, at the center of the lake, is very, very deep. And what happens is during the day, the fish all go to the deepest part of the lake. That's where they're at. But at night, the fish go to the shoreline in order to feed. That's why Simon was fishing at night. Because remember, they don't have big trawlers. They have kind of small boats that are not equipped really to cope with going out to the deep. They're shore boats. And the nets that they have are hand-thrown nets. You know, they're not big drag nets that you see in fishermen today. They're just nets that they throw over and pull in the catch. So the only way that they're going to catch fish is by staying at the shore when the fish are there at night. And Jesus, in the middle of the day, is saying, let's go out to deep water and let's fish. And Simon thinks, well, you can't fish in deep water. We don't have the equipment, and the fish won't be there. And what happens? They net in a huge catch. So much so that he has to call for a second boat, and that boat is filled as well. Both boats are filled to sinking point. When it comes to Jesus in the New Testament, there is always abundance. God is not a stingy God. He wants everything that is good for us. You know, and we see that at the wedding feast in Cana, the abundance of the wine. We see that at the feeding of the 5,000, when everyone has as much as they want to eat and there's stuff left over. We see it in the Eucharist, where everyone gets fed. God is a generous God, and he's been generous with Peter. And so we have that encounter for Peter. He sees what God does. And like all the other prophets, he goes to the next stage. Leave me, Lord. I am a sinful man. You know, Peter thinks, I'm not good enough to be in your presence here. You know, I was cynical, I was skeptical about what you were offering. I recognize my own sinfulness. You know, but Jesus has none of it. He confirms his choice. He says, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. And then they come ashore. And what does Simon do with James and John? They leave everything to follow Jesus. You know, he's done a complete U-turn. He's not interested in Jesus. Then he has to listen to Jesus. Then he encounters what Jesus can do. Then he recognizes his sinfulness and he thinks he's not worthy of the call. And Jesus invites him to follow. And he leaves everything to follow. You know, think about this. Simon has probably never left Lake Gennesaret and the surrounding regions. He's probably never traveled in his life. And now Simon is going to begin a journey. And what Jesus is doing is he was fishing. He was fishing for his disciples. And now he's got his disciples. He wants them to fish to create more disciples. And Peter's going to begin a journey that eventually is going to take him to Rome. You know, Peter would never have imagined that he would ever have gone to Rome. And he goes to Rome and he offers his life for the gospel. And we see the same thing in St. Paul. You know, St. Paul is called by God, and he describes it in today's second reading. It was like I was born again. It was like I had a new life. That when you accept the call of God, it's like being born again. It's a new life. One of the things that we need to remember whenever we read the Gospels, and particularly when it's stories about Simon Peter, is that that's also about the church. So what we hear going on for Simon Peter is what we are called to be as a church. You know, God wants us to take the risk to go out into deep water to bring men and women to him. That's the task of the church. That's the task of each and every single one of us. To take the risk, in spite of our feeling of unworthiness, to take the risk and not be afraid to respond to the call of God. Because the truth is that God calls each and every single one of us. The challenge is, how do we respond to that call?